Ladies and gentlemen, we're pleased to welcome you to our Thursday evening awards ceremony. We're glad to have everyone here this evening. We hope you enjoyed this day's festivities, the many trainings and sessions. Perhaps you've had a chance to see Seattle on this beautiful day as well. We'll invite everyone to please rise for our invocation, led by 2012 National Chaplain Jennifer Ray. She will be followed by Jennifer Salmon, 2012 President of the North Carolina Junior Chamber, who will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Please remain standing as she will be followed by the National Anthem, presented and sung by Adam Bonarak, 2012 National Awards Committee Chairman.
Walt Disney said, "It's kind of fun to do the impossible." Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us together this evening for this week of amazing adventures together, to celebrate all that we have accomplished in 2012, to renew friendships, to make new friends, to continue to make our impact on our communities. As JCs, it's kind of fun to do the impossible. We know because we do it every day. Please guide us to continue to do the impossible, to make our impact, and to create positive change every day moving forward. Amen.
We pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Oh, my goodness. Thank you very much. You may be seated. Please welcome to the podium our Masters of Ceremonies for the evening, Jim Williams.
Good evening, USJCs. I hope you're ready for some fun. We are going to have a big time tonight. We have some very special guests with us, as always. So please welcome them as they are introduced with a warm JC welcome. This group of men and women who serve the organization as its elected leadership in the last several years, notably this past year, and they meet each year, in fact, to relive past memories and press forward in lending a helping hand to the current generation of leaders. Will all members of the crew please stand? As all of you know, the U.S. Junior Chamber is proud to be the founding member of the international organization uniting JCs from all over the world. Please give a warm welcome to our representatives from JCI and its national organization members, International Vice President from JCI USA and Illinois, Joanne Rinaldo. And your JCI legal counsel from JCI USA in Michigan, Don Hetzel. Now, over the past 93 years, there have been a select group of people who've accepted the challenge of leading the best young persons organization in the world as your top official. Pleasure to introduce to you past presidents who may be in and out of the room at various times throughout the evening. Your 83rd president is the chairman of the War Memorial Trust. He is from North Dakota. He's Mike Faller. Your 86th president from Virginia, and as I understand it, suffering a little jet lag, as many of us from the Eastern time zone are, Lisa Parrish. I don't believe he's with us, but he can certainly hear you back in North Dakota. Your 89th president was John Weber. And at this time, we'd like to invite to the stage once again for your recognition, your 2012 Executive Committee, who again have worked so hard in the past year for you. Your National Vice Presidents, assigned to the states of Colorado, Maryland, Tennessee, Utah, Virginia, Wyoming, and cross-assigned to North Dakota, Abby Hansen. Assigned to Florida, Maine, Massachusetts, Minnesota, New Hampshire, Pennsylvania, West Virginia, and cross-assigned to his home state of Virginia, Chuck Nelson. Assigned to Connecticut, Kansas, Missouri, Rhode Island, South Carolina, South Dakota, and cross-assigned to her home state, I apologize, Indiana, it's Dawn Hetzel. I knew it had an I in there somewhere. Assigned to the states of Alabama, Georgia, Mississippi, Montana, North Carolina, and cross-assigned to her home state, Florida, Jasmine Allen. Assigned to Alaska, Delaware, Idaho, Nebraska, Ohio, Washington, Wisconsin, and cross-assigned to her home state, Iowa, Jennifer Gracie. Assigned to Hawaii, Indiana, Iowa, New Jersey, North Dakota, Vermont, and cross-assigned to her home state, New York, Kim Lambert. Assigned to Arizona, Illinois, Kentucky, Louisiana, Michigan, New Mexico, and cross-assigned to her home state, Minnesota, here's Laura Chesney-Gadd. And assigned to Arkansas, California, Nevada, New York, Oregon, Texas, and cross-assigned to his home state, Hawaii, Stan Fichtman. The 2012 Treasurer of JCI USA, the United States JC, Sarah Vogt. Your legal counsel, Jed Liano. Your chaplain you've just heard from, Jennifer Ray. Your membership director, Lance Algren. Your chief of staff, Faye Poisson. Your chairwoman of the board, Joni Kramer. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please rise to give a very special welcome here in Washington State to the 92nd President of the United States, J.C.'s, Travis Ahlquist, and your 93rd President, Crystal Ramsey Dice. They are escorted by the Seattle Seahawks Blue Thunder.
This way.
How about it, United States JCs for Blue Thunder? If we weren't fired up before, we are now.
Give us 2 seconds. Hold still. All right. Good to go. Good to go.
Thanks, gentlemen. All right. Well, I don't think we can top that. So let's just introduce a hardworking committee, all right? These folks had the responsibility of coordinating the judging of more than 100 book award entries and running the competitions. They've been working nonstop since they've gotten here to Seattle. They've done an outstanding job for you all year. They, of course, are your awards committee. Please recognize the 2012 USJC's National Awards Panel, your immediate past chair, Charity Stegman from North Dakota. Your committee members have included Lori Burton from Texas, Lisa Buckley from Illinois, Joanna Coletti from Illinois, Charlene Anspaugh from Kansas, and Eve Epitome from Hawaii. And now you heard him sing, you'll hear him speak in for just a moment. Your 2012 National Awards Committee Chairman is Adam Bonarek.
Thank you all so much. It has been a true pleasure and an honor to have served as the National Awards Chairman for the past 2 years under both Presidents Joni Kramer and Travis Ahlquist. And I could not have done any of this, of course, without the hardworking team behind me who have made sure that we have had everything in place every step along the way. And if you could, please give them a round of applause. This year, we did things a little differently when it came to all of the programming submissions, and we used an all-electronic online portal through JCI. And we had countless numbers of judges who helped with both that process and with the competition process yesterday. If we could have all the judges stand and be recognized. And of course, the winners that you're about to hear in a few minutes, I would like to have a great round of applause for all of the competitors who competed yesterday. If we could have all of them please stand. For me, my favorite part of having been the competition's chair has been the ability to pick the topics. I think it's a unique opportunity to be able to start a conversation, both in written form, through debate, and through the speeches in particular, about issues that are facing the JC organization. I have been so impressed and so proud for the past 2 years that people have really stepped up and truly addressed and given a lot of thought to the issues that are facing our organization through the competition topics. And I think you're going to find when you hear the two speech winners tonight that they did the exact same thing. They did a truly wonderful job, and I can't wait to hear for all of you to hear their speeches tonight. And with that, I'm going to turn it back over to MC Jim so we can find out who our winners are. Thank you very much.
Adam Bonarek in your National Awards Committee. Now, as promised, the first major one of those competition awards, the Durwood Howes Memorial. It honors our organization's top speakers, strengthening the members' communication skills through the presentation of both prepared and impromptu speeches. Speak up. The winner of the competition also has the opportunity to represent the USJCs on the international level at the JCI Conference of the Americas. Winning there will advance that person to the international competition held at the annual JCI World Congress. Your first place winner, the Durwood Howes Memorial Speak Up Competition, is from Michigan, Jennifer Mansfield. And Jennifer will present her award-winning speech in just a few moments. We're going to give her a few of those moments to get a little composure, maybe a beverage. Just water, really. Now, we move on to a couple other honors in that interim. The C. William Brownfield Memorial Award, presented each year to outstanding first-year JCs, named, of course, for Bill Brownfield, author of the JC Creed, who recognize that the spirit and enthusiasm of the Junior Chamber comes from the spirit of its first-year members. Your 2012 National Brownfield Memorial Award winner is from Illinois, Melissa Keevey. Congratulations, Melissa. Now, the John H. Armbruster Memorial is presented annually to outstanding JCs who continue to show their dedication and enthusiasm following that first year of membership. Of course, the honor is named for John Armbruster in recognition of his long and faithful service to the JCs. Your 2012 Armbruster Memorial Award goes to Nathan Martin from Hawaii. That's what we're talking about. A long-term enthusiastic JC. All right. Now, of course, you know we have a lot of great families in the organization. The Andrew and Charlotte Munganast Memorial Award is presented to outstanding families in the JCs, named for Andrew and Charlotte, one of the founders and first ladies of the Junior Chamber. So, your 2012 Munganast Family of the Year is the Wynack family from Minnesota. Congratulations to the YNAC. All right, ladies and gentlemen, exec team, you can take a seat. As promised by Chairman Adam, who comes up with these topics. The winning Howes Memorial speech had this theme. Based on the lessons of JCI impact, what are the tree trunks facing the JCs? To bring you her Howes Memorial Award-winning speech, from Michigan, please welcome Jennifer Mansfield.
Good evening, everybody. Aloha. Very new. I like it. In life, we often find ourselves applying a Band-Aid solution to many of the world's largest problems. If we see a hungry child, our first instinct is to give that child food. Through JCI Impact, I have learned not to accept the most obvious answer, but to continue to dig deeper, to reach the very root of the underlying situation. So when I see that hungry child, the solution is not to give them food, but to look deeper and to find the situation that has made them hungry. I feel that one of the biggest challenges facing the JCs today is maintaining the ambitious JC at the local chapter level. The ambitious JC is one who is creative, motivated, goal-oriented. This JC is very passionate about their causes, whether it be their career or anything in their community. This is the JC that is not going to be content with just working the next beer tent, but the leader who is going to recognize a need within their community and create a new project to address it. It is incumbent upon the leadership of this organization at the local level, from the senators to the life members to the current chapter boards, to be an inspiration to those passionate members. In many cases, chapters find themselves running the same projects that they are comfortable with year after year, running the projects that have been done traditionally, that are often created by past leadership to address a situation of historical significance. From this, two problems arise. First, the issues that faced past generations are not the same issues that we face today. In doing so, we stifle the creativity of many of these members from coming up with their own solutions. Secondly, it encourages these members to take on tasks that have already been completed. They are not using their vision to address the new issues that are in front of them. Another reason that we are losing these ambitious JCs at the local level is at the first sign of potential leadership, they are very quickly recruited to the state level. They are moved up into a position of a program manager, a training director, a regional director, often within the first year, maybe 2 years of JC membership. And while this certainly challenges and encourages those very ambitious JCs, it's also denying the members of their local chapter their mentorship, their energy, and their focus. Very often, it is that new, excited JC who's the one that sparks a chapter into taking on that new need and creating that new project that is within their local community. Which leads us to ask, why are they being recruited so early? Well, as we've historically recruited them up, that has left us with fewer mentors at our local level. The general member at the local level does not have the opportunity to learn these leadership skills from our ambitious JCs. They do not have the opportunity to work hand in hand on projects, on committees, to feel the excitement with their excited and passionate local member at their chapter level. Unfortunately, this sometimes leads to a lack of a skill set in the average general member to lead others. One of the reasons they lack that skill set is because at the local chapter level, many times we are now aiming our recruitment to be based on quantity over quality. Thank you. The JCs were originally created for and by young entrepreneurs who were already interested in bettering themselves, their businesses, and their communities. These original JCs were already leaders of their own organizations, of their own businesses. They were already passionate about their own endeavors. These young leaders at the local level were there to provide mentorship for the people that came after them. Excuse me. Unfortunately, as people moved out, when we begin to strive for growth in membership, the local level begins to not care so much who the members are. They just care what their membership number is. I believe that in order to attain some advantages and keep our ambitious JCs at the local level, we should change the way we view the individual general member. As an organization as a whole, from the local, the state, and the national level, if we change the way that we view an individual member, we will alter our recruitment, our retention, and our development of this general member. Our local chapters will begin recruiting members who are already motivated. They will begin recruiting members who are already excited and passionate. They may look at local colleges where these students have already strived to improve themselves by taking on higher education. We can look to other service organizations and professions. Those members already have a desire to help their fellow man and to lead and to be an action and a force within their community. In order to develop our individual JCs, we must give them time to grow at their own pace by exploring their passions at local levels before pursuing higher level offices before it's their time. At the local level, they'll get an opportunity to chair a project that excites them, that's passionate to them. And then they can step into a local board position where they can mentor the members around them to do the same things. And to attain retention, we simply need to inspire and encourage each individual's passions and their goals. Through this encouragement, each general member, each JC, will begin to see the many benefits that JC membership has to offer them as an individual person, not just as a club. Through this new vision of each member, the organization will begin to see many ambitious JCs becoming the building block of their local organizations. Thank you.
Keep it going, ladies and gentlemen, for Durward House Memorial Award winner, your National Speak Up Champion, Jennifer Mansfield. Now, we hear about another great speaker. And in a few moments, we'll hear from that person as well. The Masters Speak Up Competition recognizes the organization's top speakers from the nation's state officers and local chapter presidents. As the executive team reconvenes to welcome these winners to the stage, we do have two people to recognize. In second place in Masters Speak Up for 2012, from Hawaii, it's Jedediah Kay. And now, please clear the aisles to welcome with us the first place winner in Masters Speak Up from Wisconsin, Becky Bradel. And once again, we'll be hearing from Becky in just a few moments. Again, giving her a chance to get her thoughts back together as they were for the competition. How about, once again, a big round of applause for both our Speak Up winners. While Becky's getting ready, the John W. Clark Award, also known as JC Jeopardy, is a question and answer contest, or answer and question contest, designed to test your knowledge of the organization, its history, officers, goals, and activities. The awards presented recognizing the winners as the most outstanding historians in the junior chamber. The award named for John W. Clark, Tennessee resident and honorary historian. Your first place winner in JC Jeopardy is from Hawaii, Jason Nathan Martin. Aloha. All right. Now, of course, the qualities of good communication are a lot of what JCs are about, and those are evident in the written word. That is still important, even in our high technology age. The write-up competition does recognize the most outstanding writers in the junior chamber. And your 2012 write-up winners are, in third place, from Minnesota, Kerry Copet. While Carrie's getting her picture taken, in second place in write-up, from Wisconsin, is Erica Jansky. And your first place winner, having written the most outstanding essay, 2012 write-up champion from Michigan, Jennifer Kurland. I say this in your states all the time. I love it when they can't believe it. Oh, when they're surprised. Fantastic. Congratulations. Again, exec team, feel free to take a seat. We have another outstanding speech to come. The master speak up topic was, as we would say in the news, ripped from the headlines. Tornadoes in Oklahoma, bombings in Boston. How can we best step up to address these issues? To bring you her Master Speak Up winning speech from Wisconsin, please welcome Becky Bradle.
Podiums cramp my style. It's the instructor in me. I'm sorry. Everywhere around the world, someone thinks that something cannot happen to them or will not happen to them. And it's not that they think that they're invincible. Perhaps where they live is a community where everyone lends a hand and an ear when needed. A trust is developed, a camaraderie. Maybe, based on history, these communities are located in an area that geographically isn't susceptible to natural disasters. But it's when we get in this mindset, it seems like things happen, and we're unprepared. A couple months ago, I was at work, and I had just been with this firm for not even 6 months. And one day, we got a text message on our phones. And it said, a tornado is in the area. You need to take shelter immediately. My coworkers and I, we looked at each other. We immediately looked out an office window. The sun was shining in all its glory. The sky was the bluest of blue. And the clouds were big, white, and as fluffy as can be. There wasn't a tornado in sight. And we kind of laughed. We laughed and we poked fun at it a little bit. And finally, after a while, being the new associate, you're allowed to ask the stupid questions without judgment. I went to my boss and I said, what if this was real? What would have we done? He said, I don't know what we'd do. But I think the odds of that happening in this area are slim to none. I really don't think you have to worry about it. My plan is to change that mindset. My plan is to bring awareness. When I was a kid, I openly admit I come from one of those communities where everyone lends a hand, we're always out there trying to make the community bigger and better than it was before. And we don't think that kind of stuff can happen based on where we're located. But when I was a young girl in a town maybe 15 miles outside the city, a tornado rolled through. It changed members of our community's lives forever. Their homes were destroyed. They didn't know what they were going to do. Because that happened, it is in the back of my mind, it could happen. Something could happen. My plan is to bring awareness. My plan is to change that mindset. I now know where to go at work if there's a tornado. And I'm not going to the second floor hallway like my coworkers initially said. We're all piling into the bathroom on first floor. We will survive. Now, as JCs, when we take on these big national projects, the realist in me says, we're probably not going to solve the entire encompassing issue. But what our worldwide organization can do, probably better than any other one because we're so ambitious and we're young, we're going to spread awareness. We can help those communities become prepared before that next disaster hits. Individually, we can come up with plans. When I heard about the Boston bombing, all I could think about was my friend out in Boston, who I thought for sure would be on the sidewalks cheering on the runners. My heart stopped until I heard from her that she was okay. Well, obviously it didn't really stop, but it felt like it. But now, since that human-inflicted event, my friends that live out of state know if there's a natural disaster forecasted, my door is open to them. They can evacuate, and I will help keep them safe. I'm spreading awareness. I am working with family members that are out of state to develop a phone tree. So if something happens in one state, we have a family member designated in another state to contact. My family will be aware of what's going on. My plan is to spread awareness. So, with all of that said, I ask all of you, how are you going to prepare? How are you going to spread awareness before the next disaster hits? Thank you.
(laughs) 2012 Master Speak Up Champion, Becky Bradle. Well, we have some fine speakers in this organization. Congratulations to both ladies. And, of course, all competitors. The USJCs remain an organization of men and women who take action on their dreams, as you've heard tonight. We help people through projects and opportunities for personal growth. We're fortunate to have the help of seasoned JCs, who are the JCI Senate. Each year, senators are encouraged to return the favor. So to tell us all about that, please welcome with me the president of the USJCI Senate, Bruce Geddes, and Senate liaison Newton Standridge to talk about the program.
This is fantastic. Stand here in front of you and be able to look out and see those JCs that we spend our time to try to help when we're asked. Our goal is never to interfere, but to help you when you ask for help. That's what return the favor is all about. We had our opportunities to sit where you are and receive the awards that you're receiving. But as someone said earlier, we're all part of one organization. Our job is to mentor, to help, and return the favor when asked. We started this program a number of years ago, and we recognize our senators, our individual states and region, which we'll be doing in about 10 days in Cleveland. They have done an outstanding job doing that. But what's really, really important for us to be able to do that is for you to ask for the help. And we're not here to try to tell you how, but just to help you do it the way you want to do it. And that's the gist of the return of the favor. I'd like to turn it over to Newton for a few words. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, President Bruce. JCs, as we look forward into our future is you. And there's so many different things that are out there that we look at that you are looking for and seeing where we're going to be going into the future. Tomorrow is going to be an opportunity that we get a chance to visit with all of you at the Senate picnic. And we want you to come and enjoy. We will be there to host and visit with you. It's been my pleasure over the past, I'd say maybe 10 years, to be the liaison for the United States JCI Senate to the JCs. We will be introducing a gentleman tomorrow that will be following me, and look forward to a lot more years that we will be serving together. Thank you very much.
Newton Standridge and Bruce Geddes for the Senate. Now tonight, as you're aware, we come together to honor the accomplishments of your chapters, states, and members for 2012. Congratulations to everybody who served in a leadership position. Be proud of all that you have accomplished. And if the executive team would return, it's time for some of the biggies. Not that they're all not big, but these are some of the names you hear about all year that are anticipated the most. The Charles Culp Jr. Memorial Award is presented each year to the most outstanding local presidents in the USJCs. The award's named for Charles Culp from Delaware, who was state president and local chapter president of the Wilmington JCs. Here are the best of the best, ladies and gentlemen, your Charles Culp Jr. Memorial Award winners for 2012. From Southington, Connecticut, Carrie Dinder. From Nevada, Iowa, Shannon Bardol. From Alhambra, Illinois, Donnie Main. From Frankenmuth, Michigan, Jeff Ditsworth. Culp winner from North Platte, Nebraska, Linda Shea. Outstanding local chapter president from Hamburg, Pennsylvania, Colleen Whitman. Culp winner from Richardson, Texas, Jesse Wood. From Manitowoc, Wisconsin, Becky Bridle. From Winston-Salem, North Carolina, Culp winner Katie Taylor. And a Charles Culp winner from Ann Arbor, Michigan, Tom McAllister. Take another good look, ladies and gentlemen. The people who have done the hardest job in this organization and done it the best for you. Your Culp winners 2012. You've seen the best presidents. Now, the groups they headed, You've heard about some this evening, your local chapters. The Harold Marks Memorial Award, the highest achievement a junior chamber chapter can attain in the organization. The chapter getting this award is chosen from among the Clarence Howard Memorial Award winners, recognized as the most outstanding junior chamber chapter in the United States, regardless of state or regardless of number of members. It's named for Harold Marks, national director of the Arizona JCs back in 1935 and 36. Your Harold Marks Memorial Award, the best JC chapter in the United States, from Michigan, the Ann Arbor JCs! Ladies and gentlemen, the president of the Marks-winning Ann Arbor Junior Chamber, Tom McAllister.
Good evening and aloha. Wow. Not quite sure what to say here. I wasn't expecting this. I accept this on behalf of everybody from Ann Arbor. We had a great year last year. I couldn't have done it without a great team, great board of directors. Support at home from my wife Michelle and daughter Sophia, who are standing right back there looking all cute. And to my extended family, the Michigan JCs, I can't wait to take this home and share it with them and my family in Ann Arbor. Thank you very much.
Is there more? Oh, yes. Yes, there's more. The George Wilson Memorial Award goes each year to the most outstanding state organizations in the U.S. Junior Chamber with the best overall programming. It's named for George Wilson. He was, shockingly, I know. And George was actually number two. He came after Henry Giesenbier, president of the USJCs in 1921 and 22. So he was helping begin our long tradition. Winners of the Wilson are chosen from the annual report submitted by your state organizations. We have a tie. Well, isn't this interesting? So we'll do this in alphabetical order. The winners of the 2012 George O. Wilson Memorial Award are the Michigan JCs, yes, come on, and it turns out, very close in alphabetical order, the Nebraska JCs! Once again, ladies and gentlemen, your top state organizations, the Nebraska and the Michigan JCs. They love them. All right. All right, next, we have quite a few folks to speak of here. And these are President Travis's presidential medallions. Yes. It is a long list. And I haven't had a chance to rehearse these. So I might butcher a few names, I'm sorry. I apologize in advance. But please come to the stage, be recognized by President Travis, and enjoy the warmth of your colleagues and the pranks of the executive team. They love you too. Presidential medallions from President Travis go to, from Oregon, Nicole Heim. Also from Oregon, Brian Fletcher. Sherry Barnes from Louisiana. Your National Awards Committee Chairman from Michigan, Adam Bonarek. We know you had a great time in Iowa last year. Getting a presidential medallion is Paul Crawford, your Des Moines Annual Meeting Chairman. And yes, we are great in the U.S., but we're also international. Receiving medallions from Texas, Tony and Lenny Yip, your 2012 On to Taiwan World Congress chairs. You've seen her husband. Now please welcome for a medallion from Michigan, Toya Program Manager Michelle McAllister. Receiving a medallion from President Travis is your American Cancer Society Program Manager from Iowa, Angie Taylor. A chapter president from Illinois, Judy Reinholtz, receives a medallion. And in fact, we have several chapter presidents, including from Texas, Faisal Siddiqui. From Iowa, Anna Marie Bunting. Chapter president from California, Brandon Boucher. Boucher. Sorry, Brandon. I know we're close. It's Boucher. Okay, I got it right first time. Yay. Chapter president from Michigan, Nate King. Local chapter president from Iowa, Melissa Engstrom. Several state presidents received medallions. including from Nebraska, Chad Sheritz. From the New Jersey Jaycees, Dana Palma. From Pennsylvania, Carla Kramer. From Montana, Christy Owens. And state president from Michigan in 2012, Sarah Nelson. Honored with President Travis's medallions for 2012 are National Vice Presidents Abby Hansen and Laura Chesney Gadd. Also receiving presidential medallions from President Travis. From North Carolina, State President Jennifer Salmon. From my first JC State, South Carolina, Noel Bailey. A medallion goes to State President Jennifer Staley of West Virginia. Also to your national chaplain from Maryland, Jennifer Ray. Medallion honoree from Florida, your state president's coach, Crystal Ramsey Dice. And the presidential medallion recipient from Michigan, your chief of staff, Faye Poisson. How about it one more time for President Travis and all his medallion honorees? Now, we've talked about the specialness of family in the JCs. You've seen the Munganast winners. Being a leader does often call upon folks to spend hours on the road, time away from their families. And having those special people back home, it keeps things going, and as they say, keeps the home fires burning, is very important. So here are your special partner awards for those very important people without whom a lot of JCs couldn't get done what they do, or often JCs themselves, and they may work behind the scenes but offer that critical support. From California, President Henrik Helgeson recognizes his special partner, his wife Elena. From Pennsylvania, President Carla Kramer recognizes her special partner, her husband, William. In Nebraska, President Chad Sheritz couldn't have gotten it done without his special partner, his wife, Michaela. And in Texas, President Stephanie Traugott wouldn't have had the 2012 she had without her special partner, her daughter, Peyton. And no, your eyes are not fooling you. Peyton does have some purple hair going on. Congratulations and thank you to all the special partners across the country. Next is the Alan Whitfield Memorial Award. It's presented to state presidents who've shown exemplary dedication and commitment to the junior chamber movement. It's named for Alan Whitfield of Iowa, who was national president in 1936 and 37. Here are your Alan Whitfield Memorial Award winners. Please clear the aisles for the president of the Oregon JCs, Denise Huey. Whitfield Award winner from the Ohio JCs, President Carrie Hurley. Alan Whitfield Award winning state president from Hawaii, Eve Epitome. And our final Alan Whitfield Memorial Award for 2012 goes to the president of the Louisiana JCs, Christina Ruska. Your Alan Whitfield Memorial Award winners, ladies and gentlemen. Some of your very best state presidents. And here are the others. The Clayton Frost Memorial Award. Yes. Ooh. Presented annually to the most outstanding state presidents in the U.S. Junior Chamber. Named for Clayton Frost, former president of the North Carolina JCs. We use the phrase a lot. These are the best of the best. And this year, it's a short list. There are only two. It makes it that much more cool, huh? Okay, let's go with that mood. On the edge of your seats, the Clayton Frost Memorial Award winners are the state president of the Connecticut JCs, Mark Dinder. And since it's a short list, we can take our time and be equal. Your other winner of a Clayton Frost Memorial Award is from Texas, Stephanie Trogett. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, a big hand for your Frost winners, Stephanie and Mark, Texas and Connecticut. And here comes one for these folks over here, who are some of your best of the best, and have been at this a long time, and have risen to these positions that we announced earlier. The Don Cavelli Memorial Award. That's right, you know. But I have to say it anyway. Presented each year to the most outstanding national vice president in the USJCs. Named for Don Cavelli of Ogden, Utah, former president of the Utah JCs, and a past national VP. You're a Don Cavelli Memorial Award winner, and there is only one, for 2012, is Stan Fitchman. Thank you.
All right, hold it down. We got to get through this.
It is me.
There were seven other people that worked with me. And those were the seven other national vice presidents. And I call them my family this year for 2012. They were with me. But it was not just them. It was the 2012 team. It was President Travis who actually got us all together, got us all spirited, and pushed us to what we needed to do in order to make that positive change in this organization that will go forward, and that will go forward to, with my daughter when she turns 18, when she becomes a JC. Mahalo, thank you.
Cavalli Award winner, Stan Fishman. Keep that music going, Mr. DJ. Pump it up a little bit. We got some excitement here in this room. We got some United States JCs. Everybody on your feet. Warm up for this one. Something big is coming up. Everyone, find your way to your area. Make that noise. Get your hands together. And please welcome with us the young man who is wrapping it up tonight. He has led you through 2012. He is the 92nd President of the United States Junior Chamber. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, President Travis Ahlquist.
Is this thing on now? Oh, yeah. I can't speak behind from a podium either. You know, there's only 20 minutes left, so I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to fit my hour and a half speech into that 20 minutes. I started out this year with a theme of make it happen. And all the letters were capitalized except for one. And that was the letter I. And that stood for the individual. Because every dream comes from an individual. It starts with one person. And that one person starts that inspiration, brings on the next person, brings on the next person. And Katie talked about it earlier today that if you think about something, the cosmic universe has this way of fulfilling that vision. And I had a vision of doing some great things in 2012. But in order for that vision to actually happen, I needed to have the right people around me. I know about having the right people around me because I have the right people around me on a daily basis, my family. And pretty soon, I had a team of vice presidents coming on board, a team of appointees stepping up saying, I want to be part of the team. And then I started hearing about the state presidents who are stepping up to lead their state. And I started thinking, this cosmic universe thing might be kind of true. And I started thinking about all the things we could do in 2012. And as most of you know, you lay all of these lofty goals in front of you that you want to achieve, that you want to grab hold of and leave your office saying that you fulfilled. And the year goes by so quickly, much too quickly in a lot of respects, and not quick enough in a lot of others. But in the end, you have to look back and say, what were the things that we did that created an impact in this organization? We started off with that year of Make It Happen. And quickly at Leadership Academy, I asked the state presidents, I said, what is going to be your guys' it? What is going to be the it for this group of state presidents? They thought, they talked, and they came back in one united voice that they were going to make positive change happen. And that positive change was going to be the it for this group of state presidents. So quickly, the theme started to morph a little bit into making positive change happen. And quickly, we started to fulfill that mission. One of the things that I tasked this organization with was to come up with one unified mission and vision that we could move forward with. Because there was a time when you asked 10 different JCs what this organization was about, and you got 10 different answers. Now, if you ask 10 different JCs, about 5 of them are starting to say the same thing. They're starting to talk about those development opportunities that empower young people to create positive change, our mission. They're starting to talk about one unified voice for this organization. One concept that is driving us forward. How many of you know the United States Junior Chamber mission by heart? It's okay not to raise your hand because I know the truth. That is something you need to look at because it is a powerful statement. And unlike previous mission statements, it's short. So it's easy for us scarecrows to remember. And it speaks to what we are as an organization. Because it's not a new concept. When you look at that mission statement, we've been empowering young people, giving them development opportunities, and creating positive change since we were founded as an organization. It's not something new. The concept is something that we've had around for a very long time. We just now have a clear mission statement that points us forward in that direction. We also have a vision of what we want to be in the future. How many people know the vision of the United States Junior Chamber by heart? Even a little less hands went up on that one. Does anybody want to volunteer to actually stand up and say it? Prove that they know it? Go ahead. Who wants to stand up? There we go. Now you might ask, well, what does that mean to be the leading global network of young active citizens? Young active citizens, are we already the leading global network? We're a global network, young active citizens, but are we leading? And leading in the respect more than just numbers. Are we leading? Are we leading the charge for tackling the issues that are facing our communities, our states, and our nations? Are we leading the charge in solving those issues? That's what it means to be that leading global network. And in order for us to solve a lot of these issues, we're going to need a global network. We're going to need a network throughout the United States, throughout other countries, to solve a lot of these issues. We need to have that. It's that voice. And you look back on that team. It was a team that had many, many discussions. Crystal can attest for a lot of those discussions with the state presidents, where I went to her and said, here's what we want to do, bring it to the state presidents, see what they say. And they would always come back and say, here's what our thoughts are. Here's what we think is best for the organization. Here's where we think we should go. We would talk about it as an executive committee team, look at it and say, yes, let's move forward. Let's move this organization forward into the future. Been a member of this organization pretty much half of my life. Joined when I was 22. I'm now 41. Yeah, I might get a little choked up. But I'm one of those people that when I started out, I needed those development opportunities. Trust me, I needed them. Uh-huh. Those people who know me, uh-huh. But I got that empowerment and was able to do some great things within this organization, things that not many people get the opportunity to do. And I don't take that for granted. And I know that this organization is moving forward in a positive direction because I see the things that are happening this year in 2013. And I hear people talking about the organization, talking about positive change, talking about solving issues, talking about getting those young people into our organization so that we can be the leading global network of young active citizens. And when you think about that mission statement, empowerment, development opportunities, creating positive change, it's all mute without one thing. And that's the young people. Because you can provide all the development opportunities you want. But if there's no young people there to take advantage of them, they're never going to be empowered to create positive change. And the more young people that get that, the more positive change and the greater positive change we can affect. And I firmly believe that we're within a few years of this organization climbing in membership on a consistent basis, year after year after year after year. How many people out here believe that? And I'm not talking about a one-year flash. I'm talking about consistent. People coming in, seeing what we're doing and going, I want to be a part of that. See what these guys are doing? I want to be a part of that. I want to be a part of those change makers. I want to be one of those young active citizens. And they're going to see it from your actions. They're going to see it from the things that you're doing. They're going to see it from those projects that are going out and impacting the community. They're going to see it from the leaders that you produce. They're going to see it in every aspect of our organization. You got to go out there and live it. Go out there and live this mission. Internalize it into your heart. Because that's the only way this mission really does what it needs to do, is when those aspects are so ingrained into your fibers that you can't help but to live that mission out. It's just a natural aspect of what you do in this organization. I want to take just a few brief moments before I finish and exit off stage for the last time as a national president, because you know, national presidents, they try not to give them the mics too often after we're done. I want to thank the team, the executive team that stood up to be a part of that team and stood with me whole year long. I want to thank the state presidents who stepped up to lead their respective states. I want to thank all of the members who become part of this organization and do what they can to further it. I want to thank those people who came before me and those people who believed in me and believed that we could lay a foundation in 2012 to move it forward. And the last two people I want to thank were two groups. One is my Heavenly Father above. Without him, couldn't do anything. And I know that he sent me the other group of people to give me that ability to do what I need to do. My family, my wife, my two beautiful daughters who inspire me on a daily basis. I told you I was going to get a little emotional. Well, that's okay, because I'm not afraid to cry. I cry at movies all the time. Ask my wife when she looks over at me and goes, "It's Toy Story 3. You're crying? But he's going to die." You know the scene. Come on. Tell me you guys didn't cry too. Thank you guys for allowing me to lead you in 2012 and allowing me to fulfill my it. And my dream of laying a foundation to move this organization forward so that my daughters can join a thriving, growing organization that everybody wants to be a part of. That was my it. And I firmly believe you helped me fulfill it. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 92nd President of the United States Junior Chamber, Travis Ahlquist. Would President Travis's executive team please assemble with him on the stage? Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Chief of Staff Faye Poisson.
They're coming at me from all sides.
That's exactly how we planned it. President Travis, you had a vision of making it happen in 2012. And while not every obstacle that we met, we overcame, I think we did it together as a team. We did it united as one, with one voice, as you said earlier. And as a result of your passion and dedication and commitment to this organization, you were able to lead us in the right direction so that we can continue to move this organization forward. And so as a team, we'd like to say thank you by providing you with this gift. And we're hoping that in your more spare time that you have now, that you'll be able to take up something that you might have enjoyed in your past. I did have a little conference call with the First Lady to find out a little about the things that you used to do before you became a JC and so involved. And so we're hoping that this small token of our appreciation will help make your day a little bit brighter and remind you about why you made it happen in 2012. So thank you.
They move. They move.
92nd President.
Oh, awesome. Yes. I actually was running out of room on my other. I collect golf balls from my travels, from the places I attempt to play golf at. And all my other golf cases are only have a few remaining spots left. So now I have a lot more spots to collect for the places that I can visit and the places where I will take huge divots out of the grass at.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
One more time, ladies and gentlemen, for President Travis and his 2012 team. Now, ladies and gentlemen, please address your attention to the screens. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it truly begins. Please welcome, for her inaugural address, your 93rd president of the United States Junior Chamber, from Florida, Crystal Ramsey Dice.
Moves, but it seemed a little frightening, and you saw them earlier. You had your dollars out. That's all I got today. I am going to be brief because I know we are ready to have some cocktails and celebrate 2012. I did want to share something with you this evening. I want to talk about determination. Determination is what it took to get here. Determination that no matter what was happening, and lots of things happened over the course of the last several years, that I was not going to give up the dream of being a national president. Now, when I was a little girl, I had these big, lofty dreams. I know, you can't believe it, but it's true. Of course, I wanted to be a princess. That's why I have three crowns. You know, the outfit that you saw yesterday, that was all mine. We didn't have to purchase that. I have that at home. Cannot have enough tool in your life ever. I wanted to be the first woman president for the United States. I know that dream is gone now that Hillary Clinton has done it. Well, sort of. Just kidding. But when you're little, you have all of these ambitions and these dreams. Talk to these young ladies, talk to my son, they'll tell you the 50 things they want to do. First, my son wanted to be a veterinarian, then he hang out with Matt Chastain, he wants to be a photographer assistant. Matt's on my list. Somebody's got to take care of Mama when she gets old. But when I was little, I wanted to be a leader. That's all I ever talked about. I wanted to do something where I was leading people and doing things and making big changes. And thinking about becoming the sixth female president of the United States Junior Chamber seemed like a pretty big deal. I was following in the footsteps of Sidney Ward Tompkins, Dr. Julie Metzger, Lisa Parrish, Denise O'Neill, and Joni Crema. And that was a pretty big deal. It was a pretty big deal to be the sixth female president, to serve with the third world president that was a female. That was a pretty big deal. So how was I going to do this? How was I going to accomplish this? How was I going to keep on the right track, doing the right things to make sure that I got to achieve my dream? Determination. When Henry Giesenbier came up with this organization, he came up with a vision. He came up with a thought. He came up with a plan. He wanted to have an organization that trained people to be entrepreneurs and to be leaders in non-traditional ways. He wasn't going to have you come and work a job. He wasn't going to have you come and attend a university. He was going to train you by getting you out in the community and having you make an impact. And that, my friends, are what we continue to do. Our vision's different. You heard past President Travis talk about our vision a little while ago. We've changed our vision from what we were 93 years ago because we've changed with the times. But what the organization is, the determination, the drive that we have to be successful, is the same organization that it was 93 years ago, and that's what we need to keep taking out to the public. We are active citizens who continually create positive change. No matter what we're doing, no matter what city, state, country we live in, that's what we do, and that's who we are. I'm sure you were filled with anticipation as you started 2013. I know I was. In my pajamas, when IPP Travis called me at midnight East Coast time to pass over the reins, I was a little nervous. I was a little scared. I wondered if I could do it. Would people accept some of the changes that we had talked about preparing for 2013? Would people think these were good ideas or think I was crazy and hang me up by my toes? I don't know. But we had to do something, and we had to do something big, and we had to build on top of that foundation that was laid out for us in 2012. And I can tell you, walking into June, we have had huge accomplishments. We changed our blue chip program to civic leadership certification so we can continue to prove that we are civic leaders. We changed our passport program to passport to civic leadership. Again, we are civic leaders. We updated our website. We updated our database. We made an app, not just for the Droid, but for the iPhone. We got involved with a marketing company who launched a campaign for us just this week to send out blogs and tweets and Facebook posts to get young people interested in what we're doing and attract them to our organization so we can become more powerful and create more positive change. We have made partners. Nothing But Nets, LULAC, Procter & Gamble, Go Kickball, or as Joel likes to say, G-O Kickball. Same thing, Go Kickball. We have worked with these individuals. We have gotten grants from these individuals. We're putting on huge programs like the bus tour because of these individuals, because we want to make a large impact. But I think one of the coolest things that's happened this year so far is that we have strengthened our partnership with JCI, and we co-hosted the Conference of the Americas, where we sat proudly in the front of the room and took home, yes, my friends, 6 international awards. We have the top area president, local chapter president, Katie Taylor. We have the top local chapter, Ann Arbor, who also brought home the top community long-term impact projects. We have the top Omiari project with the Houston Asian JCs. We have the top new chapter with Hobbs, New Mexico. And we are the best national organization for a membership program with our growth and development program. We are proudly showing everyone else what we have known for the longest time, that JCI USA, United States Junior Chamber, and USJC's kicks tail all the time. We have wonderful projects, we do wonderful things, and we need to share that with everyone, non-members, members, to let them know that we are serious about making a positive impact. We are serious about daring to act. We are serious about making changes in this organization, because we will be the premier organization for young people. We will grow and continue to build our membership so that we will be around for all of the young people that are sitting in this room today, so that they can be members 10 years, 15 years, 20 years from now. Past President Travis and myself will hobble in the back of the room and talk about how wonderful it was when we ran it back in 2012 and 13. Before I leave, I wanted to share a story with you. As I said, as I prepared in December to take the reins from IPP Travis, I was really nervous, very excited, but nervous, and thinking, were people going to buy into some of the changes that we had? Were people going to be receptive to some of the things that we felt that we needed to do to make this huge impact? And while doing that, of course, you have all of your advisors who tell you you're wonderful and you're fabulous, because that's what they're supposed to do. And my presidential advisor, who couldn't be here with us tonight, Dwayne Sumner, shared a story with me that I want to share with you tonight. Dwayne said, I want you to close your eyes. I want you to imagine that you're walking down the railroad track and you can't see anything. Too dark. Can't see what's on your right. Can't see what's on your left. Could be brush. Could be sand. Could be concrete. But you can see directly in front of you, so you just keep walking. But then a train comes, and it's coming right at you. And the light gets closer, and the light gets closer, and you know if you stay on the track, you're gonna die. But what do? You don't know what's on the right, you don't know what's on the left, you jump. You have to jump and take the chance. So I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for all of you jumping with our 2013 team to continue to make these positive changes, to continue to make positive impact, to continue to dare to act, and to continue to turn your passion into action.
President Crystal Ramsey Dice. And now we take a moment, ladies and gentlemen, to introduce the rest of her 2013 team, those who are going to assist her in leading you throughout the rest of this year. Please clear the aisles and welcome with us National Vice Presidents. Assigned to the states of Colorado, Indiana, Massachusetts, Michigan, New York, Pennsylvania, and Utah, cross-assigned to her home state of Wisconsin, Tracy Chadon. Assigned to Connecticut, Delaware, Hawaii, Missouri, New Mexico, and Virginia, cross-assigned to her home state, Texas, Catherine Ching Arif. Assigned to Georgia, Kansas, Kentucky, Minnesota, Rhode Island, Texas, cross assigned to his home state of Iowa, Paul Crawford. Assigned to Maine, North Carolina, New Hampshire, New Jersey, South Carolina, and West Virginia, cross assigned to her home state, Virginia, Valerie Hart. Assigned to Idaho, Maryland, North Dakota, Oklahoma, Wisconsin, and Wyoming, cross assigned to her home state, Montana, Jermaine Blum. Assigned to Arizona, Florida, Iowa, Louisiana, Nevada, and Tennessee, cross assigned to his home state, North Carolina, Troy Powell. Assigned to Arkansas, California, Illinois, Mississippi, Montana, and Washington, cross assigned to her home state, Louisiana, Monica Riggs. And National Vice President assigned to Alaska, Alabama, Nebraska, Ohio, Oregon, and Vermont, cross assigned to her home state right here in Washington, Tara Winkler. Continuing as your treasurer, Sarah Vogt. Continuing as your legal counsel, Jed Leano. Your chaplain in 2013 is Stan Fitchman. Your membership director, Faye Poisson. Chief of Staff 2013, Lance Algren. Your state president's coach will be Jennifer Ray. And your chairman of the board, 92nd president, Travis Allquist. Here they are, ladies and gentlemen, your 2013 executive team, the United States Junior Chamber. Now, This group is fortunate to have a talented group of state presidents leading your organization as the 2013 Board of Directors. So please welcome your state presidents. Please welcome, from California, President Kerry Spencer. For the Colorado JCs, President Renee Verspoor. In Connecticut, it's President Tracy Wood. The president of the Delaware JCs, Eric Norimatsu. For the Florida Junior Chamber is President David Dale. The Hawaii JCs are led this year by President Jay Raimondo. Please welcome from Illinois, President Heather Weinmiller and her VIP, Scott Ulrich. Leading the Indiana Junior Chamber, President Noel Dunkel. In 2013, the president of the Iowa JCs is Tom Welchens. The Kentucky JCs are led by President Caitlin Askerpour. Leading the Louisiana Junior Chamber in 2013, President Christina Ruska. The Maryland JCs are headed by President Jeff Rajam. Please welcome the president of the Michigan Junior Chamber, John Bedeen, and his VIP, Nina Perko. Heading the Minnesota JCs, President Chris Wilkie. The Mississippi Junior Chamber is led by President Lisa Foster. Leading the Missouri JCs in 2013, President Kristen Johnson and her husband Randy. Leading the Montana JCs, President Justin Witzke. His VIP is Corey Lefevre. Out front of the Nebraska JCs in 2013, President Carrie Fisher. The New Jersey JCs, led by President Dana Palma. Heading the New York Junior Chamber in 2013 is President Angie Collins. The president of the Ohio Junior Chamber, Kimberly Valentine. The Pennsylvania JCs are led by President Krista Muir. For the South Carolina JCs, it's President Heather Vardell. The South Dakota Junior Chamber has as its president Travis Arneson. His wife Edith is with him. The Tennessee JC's president is Paul Ottinger. Leading the Texas Junior Chamber is President Jonathan Fong. The Virginia JC's president is Lillian Chang. Here to lead the Washington JC's, President Danny Clyde and his wife Lara. Heading the West Virginia JC's, President Chris Richmond and her fiance Chuck Mitchell. Leading the Wisconsin Junior Chamber in 2013, President Brian Devitt. And heading the Wyoming JC's, President Kathy Rosenthal and her husband Shane. Ladies and gentlemen, one of our first duties is for President Crystal to swear in this outstanding team of folks who are leading you. President Crystal.
Good evening. The office to which you've been elected is one of dignity and importance. In accepting this office, you undertake a responsibility which is not to be assumed lightly nor carelessly discharged. You are charged with the duties of seriously and resolutely furthering the objectives of the Junior Chamber movement. With the policy and bylaws as your guide, you must be ever ready to exercise the functions of the office to which you have been entrusted. Further, you are charged with governing this organization according to the laws of democracy, for which every person who wishes to speak shall be heard. Toward the end, that in every matter considered, the best opinion shall prevail through the expressed will of the majority and the best course of action followed. Do you accept this charge? Please, state presidents, raise your right hand and repeat after me. I state your name. Don't they rock? Do solemnly swear or affirm, that I will faithfully execute the office of state president of the Junior Chamber, JCI USA, and United States JCs. And will, to the best of my ability, serve as a living example of this organization's philosophies and beliefs. So help me God. Congratulations, 2013 Class of State Presidents!
Your leadership for 2013, ladies and gentlemen. And now as we close tonight's ceremony and adjourn to celebrate the inauguration, we ask all of you to stand and join together in those words that unite not only us here in the United States, but JCs worldwide. And to lead us in the JC Creed, the 2012 President of the Hawaii Junior Chamber, Eve Epitome.
amazing. Aloha, everyone. Please join in with me and to recite the JC Creed. We believe
that faith in God gives meaning and purpose to human life, that the brotherhood of man transcends the sovereignty of nations, that economic justice can best be won by free men through free enterprise, that government should be of laws rather than of men, that Earth's great treasure lies in human personality, and service to humanity is the best work of life.
Thank you, JCs. Thank you, leadership. Thank you, President Crystal. Have a great time, everybody.